So today we're going to be working on colorimetric tests, discussing color changing as a guide to discovering explosives or drugs or what have you. And so these are ancient methods, you know, putting a reagent on there, getting a color change. This goes back to detecting poisons and so on. And so again, we still keep these color changing tests because of the deep history that they have. You know, and it's going to be hard to fool them because it's based on the chemistry that hasn't changed since the beginning of the world. Now, the thing about some of these colorimetric molecules or complexes is that they're enormous, some of them. And so the normal functional groups that you know of, like an aldehyde, a ketone, or a carboxylic acid, you know, those are pretty easy to find in a molecule. But these overarching color structures are just too complex. We have classification names, but we kind of depart from the IUPAC names because the molecules are too big. We do use some of their functional behavior to classify them, though, like acid-base. We talked about that with liquid-liquid extraction. And so even though the molecule is enormous, we can find an acid group on there or a base group and put it in that classification of acid or base. That'll tell us how to extract it. From multi-components in one particular matrix to pull one into the aqueous phase or push one into the organic phase. But there are also other classifications, like their effect. Are they a hallucinogen? Are they a central nervous system depressant or stimulant? And then schedule, which is a legal classification. Is this a schedule 1, 2, 3 drug? And so we'll get into that in a couple more lectures. But we'll focus on the chemistry of these, not the analytical methods, because there's whole volumes of analytical methods. And so we would never get through them if we started talking about each individual method. Now we'll show 4 or 5 tests this morning, but as far as knowing which test detects which thing, I'm not so interested in that. I'm more interested in just you knowing the color centers of these molecules and the types of chemistry. So here's some of the functional classification of molecules. You'll see acidic, neutral and basic molecules. Alkaloid is a new word for you. Perhaps it's a plant extract. And so even though it sounds like it's basic, not all of those are basic, but many of them are. So alkaloid is not synonymous with basic. Alkaloid is just saying that it's a plant extract. And then a semi-synthetic would be something that's an alkaloid that's then gone through a synthetic process. So heroin would be a semi-synthetic. It would be an alkaloid, because it's an opiate, but then you acetylate it. You do chemistry on it, and you take the 2 hydroxyl groups and put acetic acid esters on there.
So the alkaloid would be marijuana? Just take marijuana?
Yes, yes. THC would be an alkaloid. It's a plant extract, and that's the active ingredient. So, just like morphine is the active ingredient, but it comes out of the latex of the poppy seed pod. Yeah, and so you just scratch that poppy seed pod, and the milky substance that comes out is a fair percentage of morphine.
In poppy.
Yeah, so that's why poppy crops in Afghanistan were so lucrative, because that's where they got morphine and then made heroin and sold it on the drug market. And then you have synthetic drugs that are just total, you know, the results of organic chemistry. And so we have some of those over here, phenylethylamines and so on. We use color tests to detect these. They're still used. They're very good. Because the eye is so sensitive. I mean, you can detect very small changes in absorbance because that causes a slightly different color. And so if you were to look at the absorption spectrum of an acid-base indicator, I've done this for bromocresyl green, you know, the yellow substance and the green substance, you change the pH and it goes from yellow to green, very stark endpoint. But if you look at the absorption spectrum of the yellow form and the green form, it's just a small change in one small portion of the spectrum that causes a completely different perception in the eye. So it's enough to just change which pigment in your retina is stimulated by a small amount, and you perceive a huge change in color. The same thing with photography. They've made these camera sensing elements to mimic the eye. And so the camera sensing elements are also very sensitive to slight changes in the reflections or absorbent spectrum. And so you can see a drastic change in color with just a very small change in absorbance. Most of these screening tests are colorimetric. And so this is from the book, 80% 86% of the labs use these spot tests for marijuana, for cocaine and other alkaloids, the Marquis reagent for opiates, and this PEDMAB for LSD. And so if you have a suspected, you know, white powder, it could be cocaine, some other alkaloid, an opiate, or LSD, you could run these color tests, and it would help you classify what that white powder is. It's pretty simple, too, because, you know, you just can test the native material. So you just take a small amount of the residue, push it off to the side, pull it up with a wipe, and then you can do this color test on the wipe. Or sometimes you will take, like for marijuana, an extract of the leaves, put ether in it, and extract the compounds with ether. And then you do the color test on the ether extract. Then you follow up. So these would be screening tests. So what is a screening test? It's just a simple indication that the substance is there. And you know, that's not enough for a conviction, right? Because there could be interference. There could be other things that cause that color change. But it is what they call a presumptive test. So when you get a color change, you presume it's marijuana. Then you follow up with a confirmatory test, like FTIR, LCMS, or something like that. There are other color changes that aren't necessarily the result of a color test. It's just color evidence. And so if you were to see, and that's put in as a warning, if you're ever at the tank exchange, at the convenience store or Home Depot, and that little screen pops open and you're about to get a new propane tank out, and it's a brass valve on the top. And if it's covered in blue residue, ask for a new tank. In fact, tell them that they need to report this tank. You're probably never going to see this because the people that exchange those tanks, the companies, you know, they know what the deal is. But that tank has been used to hold ammonia, anhydrous ammonia, for clandestine meth production. So they'll take propane, an empty tank, and then they'll go to an agricultural, you know, tank for fertilizing a field, and some farmers will inject ammonia gas into the soil, and bacteria turn it into nitrate, and so they fertilize their crops that way. It's a very cheap way to fertilize the ground. But then you have these huge tanks out in a rural area of anhydrous ammonia, and that's a good reagent for making meth. So if you have a propane tank, you go and you hook up your modified hoses to this large thing, open up the valves, and you steal some anhydrous ammonia from the farmer. He's not going to notice that it's missing. Okay, but these black brass valves react with the ammonia. And so this valve here is all corroded and blue, and you don't know how thin the metal is. It could have really corroded from the inside and been very thin. And so then you turn the knob and the valve pops off. And it says explosive risk. It's probably not going to explode on you like you see a Hollywood explosion, but it's going to blow propane all in your face. And if you've got a pilot light lit or something else that's burning, you got a campfire, you've got a huge propane, that might be an explosion. So it's a huge risk. So what is this color compound? It's not any kind of reagent that you put on there. It's just naturally blue. Do you know what brass is?
Copper and tin?
No. Copper and something else.
Nickel. No. Zinc? No.
Yeah, it's zinc. Oh. So it's just a mixture of various percentages of copper and zinc. It's very cheap. Zinc's cheap. Copper's not so cheap, but you mix them together. You stretch the copper a little further by mixing it in with zinc, you make brass. And it's a solution. It's actually a homogeneous mixture. So that's a solid solution of brass and zinc. It can be a various, a different strain of solution than a compound. Going back to freshman chemistry, is a compound has a particular ratio of atoms, like water, H2O. Okay, you don't talk about water being, you know, 35% to 45% hydrogen, right? There's no range in percentages. It's H2O, but brass is maybe 20% copper and 80% zinc or some varying percentage. And so it's the copper that reacts with the ammonia. See, here's the different aqueous ions. Here's zinc. It's colorless, but copper is blue. And this structure here, inorganic color, like, oh, no. Okay. There's copper, two waters, four ammonias. This is a deep blue substance, and if it crystallizes, when the water dries out, maybe you have water molecules in its crystal structure, you get this blue residue. And so this is blue because the copper in that brass valve has been leached out by the ammonia and moisture. Okay. Occasionally they'll find where these valves have busted when the tank was holding ammonia, and the person will breathe in a substantial amount of ammonia and be dead at the scene. And so they'll show up and there's a tank with a cracked valve and a person dead and, you know, blood because their lungs dissolved. And that's not so good. So this is just a warning that if you see blue valves, run. And so this, again, takes advantage of our eye, super sensitive detector. It can see down to 1 to 50 micrograms, which is wonderful because, you know, especially with these more recent appearance of fentanyl and fentanyl derivatives, which are being mixed in with other opioids to make them stronger. The one that's got most people worried is carfentanil, which is 5 to 10,000 times more potent than fentanyl. And fentanyl is comparably potent to morphine, so 5,000 times more potent than morphine. Yeah, and so what it does is it basically causes your breathing to stop. And there was a police officer that had some of this on his shoulder, so I've heard, and he brushed it off, and it went through his skin and killed him. Yeah, that a lethal dose can be as small as 1 milligram. 1 milligram. So you think about 1 milligram. You've been in lab. You've weighed things out. You know, that's 0.001 gram. And that could be a lethal amount.
Isn't carfentanil
like
an elephant tranquilizer?
Yeah, so that's what I've heard too, that they use it to take down large animals as a tranquilizer. And so the toxin is the dose, and the dose is based on your body mass. So if you have a large body mass like an elephant, you can hit them with 1 milligram and it just makes them sleepy. You hit us with 1 milligram, it kills us. Our breathing stops. Yeah, so it's a problem. But we would need something with a really sensitive detection limit. And this is pretty good, 1 to 50 micrograms.
Yeah.
So 0.05 milligrams. And so that's good. That's about 1/20th of a lethal dose. And so then if you have some on the table here and you scoot it over and if we develop a spot test for carfentanil or any of the fentanyl derivatives, we can spray a little bit on there and look for a color change and say, okay, this is not table salt, it's not flour, not sugar, it's not cocaine or whatever. This is an opioid and it may be very, very dangerous. So I'm going to put on my personal protective equipment and clean this up. I'm not going to just get some on my sleeves and wipe it off because it could be absorbed through the skin. This is the problem with color tests, though, is inexperience can yield inaccurate results. So, I mean, not knowing what color to look for, that's obvious, right? But also timing, because most of these reactions have kinetics associated with them. So it may develop slow, it may develop fast. If it develops slow and you don't wait long enough, you're going to miss it. If it develops too fast and you look the other way, you missed it. So again, you've got to get experience with these tests. And most of them have, like the pregnancy test, most of them have a verification color that tells you the test is working, and some other kind of color that tells you it's a positive result for what it's testing for. And so you'll have a test solution, you spray it, that guarantees your reagents are fresh. And then you take the wipe and test what you're looking for. And now that you know your reagents are fresh, you can test and be confident that the color change is real and it's not just a mistake. This also is very easily adapted to thin layer chromatography. So if you have a complex mixture, you can separate the spots and then spray a developer on top and you get a color change and you see different colors in the spots. Okay. And wipes, you can wipe the whole desktop and then test the wipe. What you've done there is concentrated enormous amount. So how can you concentrate? You know, let's see, this is about 2 square centimeters. Okay, and that's sort of the industrial hygiene test method is to take a filter paper and put 2 fingers behind it. That's 2 square centimeters. All right. And if you wipe it 5 centimeters, okay, that's 10 square centimeters. Okay. So 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, or no, 10. Yeah, up to 100. So you've tested 100 square centimeters, and so you've consolidated that quite a bit. In fact, you've got a factor of 50 multiplication. So you've just concentrated the surface 50 times. If you do it 1,000, you've concentrated it quite a bit more. And so you can test really small amounts on a surface with 2 fingers and a piece of filter paper. And then you spray that developer on there, and you can test for the substance. Freshman level colorimetry, you know, we covered this in PCHEM. The color wheel, if there's a absorption in the yellow, the substance will appear violet or dark blue. But what if there's multiple peaks, asymmetric peaks, strongly colored substances, and so on? We'll cover a little bit more of that later. But this is what that PCHEM lab was about, you know, simulating the color. And I just show this because I'm so proud of this paper. That we were able to actually get the color of phenolphthalein from a Gaussian calculation. So here's a Gaussian calculation calculating this phenolphthalein molecule in space with no water, no acid base, or anything like that, and yet we were able to accurately get the color to match. But what was interesting is we had to rotate this carboxylic acid group. So that's going to be pH dependent.
Wow.
And so whenever there's a pH change, when it goes basic, this molecule is deprotonated, and now we have this gap here, the 517, because that carboxylic acid group is now rotated and not interacting with the ring structure down here, and that gave us a more accurate match to the experimental color. So anyway, that was kind of fun. And the point is that now we really do understand how these colorimetric molecules work, and we can actually model their electron clouds. Here's some special terminology. I had heard of redshift and blueshift, right? Most of the time you'll see those, but sometimes you'll run across in papers these words hypsochromic and bathochromic. And I had no idea what that was. So this, you know, I'm assuming that you don't either. So let's learn these words. Hyperchromic, hyper meaning more, right, greater. So a stronger peak, a stronger color would be hyperchromic. So you've got a light pink solution and it goes to dark pink. It's still pink. Okay, so it's a hyperchromic shift. It's gotten stronger in terms of its color. Or if it went from dark red to pale red, it's gone hypochromic. It's less colored. If you have a substance that's yellow and it shifts to the green, you've got to know which direction that is in the spectrum. So is green to short wavelength or long wavelength from yellow? Green is a shorter wavelength than yellow. Okay. And so that would be a hypsochromic shift of the color. Yeah. And so the color is shifted towards the blue, it'd be a blue shift or a hypsochromic shift. If it shifts towards the red, it's a bathochromic shift. And I think of baths are warm and red is warm. That's the way I remember it. So bathochromic is just a nice warm bath.
Do you know
the red part of the spectrum? Yeah.
You know the origins of those prefixes, or?
No, I don't. Yeah. So anyway, this is just a nice little figure for you to put a star by. So if those terms are used, you'll know what they mean. So let's talk about the colorants. Okay. There's two different types: a pigment and a dye. And it really doesn't have anything to do with the molecule. It has more to do with the molecule in comparison to its matrix. So if it's just suspended as an insoluble substance in the matrix, that's a pigment. But if it's dissolved, molecularly dissolved in the matrix, it's a dye. But there's not necessarily, you can't say this colorimetric molecule is a pigment always. It might be a pigment in this solution and a dye in that solution. So there's no native thing that's different to make something a pigment and another thing a dye. Okay. And then, like I said, the difference between these two is not that important except for paint and some inks. But these are the four families of dyes or pigments or colorants. Colorants is more general, so you could just probably use the word colorants. And these are the ones that I want you to know. The aromethanes, I should say. So you've got aro meaning aromatic ring and a methane group. So a carbon bonded to three things. An azo dye, so you need to look for that azo functional group. Nitro or nitroso dye, so you look for the nitro or nitroso functional group. And then the carbonyl type. And carbonyls would kind of capture that class of extended unsaturated regions. Typically they'll have a carbonyl or some sort of non-bonded electrons on an oxygen that can do electron transfer to the ring system. So let's look at these. Here's the four structures that we just talked about. Here's the triaromethane, it's easy for me to say, triaromethane group. So here's the carbon in the middle, And again, it's stabilized by delocalization. If that's been, the hydrogen's been pulled off, then it's positively charged. If that, that goes someplace else in the molecule, then you can have electrons come and stabilize that, that carbon. And you've got these three arrow, rings or aromatic systems. Now, don't be deceived. This cannot be a planar structure. Why can it not be a planar structure? So this thing looks planar as it's drawn, but it can't be planar.
It's true. That's sp3 hybridized. That's sp3 hybridized.
What'd you say?
It's trigonal planar.
Well, like this carbon would want to be trigonal planar. Well, it is, but these three rings can't be in the same plane. Why will they twist, though? This is where organic chemists get us into trouble. It wants to be flat because of the delocalization of the electrons. So why won't it be planar? Why are the organic chemists and their laziness screwing us up on this?
They're not drawing the hydrogens.
They're not drawing the hydrogens. Where would that hydrogen be for that ring right there? It would be right here. What about this
one?
Same spot.
So
those darn organic chemists are messing up the world. Okay, they're lazy and they're leaving the hydrogens off, and they make you think that this is going to be planar all the way around. And I bet that's going to mess you up in inorganic too, when you're trying to do the point groups of these things, and you see that, oh, that's flat, so it's going to be a horizontal plane, when it can't be flat. Because those hydrogens, the steric hindrance of those hydrogens, are going to bump into each other. Those rings have to be twisted like a boat motor, like a propeller.
All it has is identity.
So yeah. Yeah. Now this thing, if you've got all this other junk on there, it's going to be C1, you know. But the point is, if you just have, yeah. And so, if you twist those rings a little bit, then you break that horizontal plane, and you've got now something that could be twisted to the right or twisted to the left, and you've got two different types of molecules, different stereoisomers. Okay. So then. The carbonyl dyes, you have extended electron cloud regions, pi regions. Their function in making this colored are the N to pi star transitions. So the non-bonded electrons on the oxygen can go up to the pi star, open pi star orbitals. And that's going to be a pretty small gap, which means it's going to be in the visible region. So the gap decreases with the more extended pi cloud. And so then that means that it moves into the red region. And so these molecules can be great colors. If it absorbs in the red, it's going to be, you know, a blue or a green substance. And so you're going to see some fantastic colors out of all of these. Here's a nitro dye. So NO2 group is a nitro. Just an NO group is a nitroso. And so those, if you find those, then you'll certainly say, okay, then it's probably a nitro dye. And then here's the azo linkage. See here? So nitrogen-nitrogen double bond, and you got the lone pairs up here, and then the single bond to whatever the R groups are. Now, these can be cis or trans. And so they try to hold this group in a planar structure, these three bonds, but then when you hit that with light, you get essentially a pi to pi star transition, and this becomes a single bond and can rotate. And that's what's happening with rhodopsin in your eye. So it's light hits it, and that molecule gets rid of its steric hindrance, okay, and it rotates to the excited state. And then when that double bond is reformed, it snaps back down. But that's enough motion to trigger your nervous system. And so rhodopsin and the photon of light hits that azo group, you get this jump, and it triggers the nerve. This is why I've detected a photon, and then it resets. And it resets pretty fast.
What makes it reset back to its original position?
Again, it's up in energy, and so when the electrons, to get back down to energy, those electrons reform that pi bond, and it snaps back down. Now you might think, well, that's way too much torque. How can the electrons give that molecule torque? But remember, this thing is vibrating all the time. And so when it vibrates a little bit closer to its normal place, then that double bond is reestablished and it snaps back down.
So there would never be a case where it would go almost trans to itself?
Trans or cis, I'm not sure. I'd have to look it up again. But this could be, it could be trans and it could pop up and then pop back down. Yeah. Okay. But it's this azo type detection that our eye is using. Pretty fascinating. So I just want you to be able to look at the molecules and these colors. colorimetric centers that we're about to see and recognize whether it's an aryl system, a methine, a carbonyl extended pi system, a nitro type dye, or an azo type dye. Pretty simple stuff, but these are going to be important to the chemistry of those colorants. And so here's the detecting amphetamine and methamphetamine using the Marquis reagent. Now, we're not told much in the book about what the Marquis reagent is, but we are shown what it does. And so look at these are the reactants over here with the Marquis reaction, and all of a sudden we have this compound. Where do these pieces come from? Well, notice it's dimerized the two amphetamines. And it's dimerized them at the aromatic ring. So this is a new carbon. So these here just had hydrogens all around them, but now there's a new carbon joining those two ring systems.
Okay.
And so is it azo? Nope. Is it nitro? Nope. Is it carbonyl? Nope. I see two aryl groups and a methine, you know, this carbon with three things bonded to it. So it's an aryl methine system that's given us the color for the Marquis reagent and amphetamine.
So you're saying that carbon is bonded to
three different things? Well, the hydrogen, yeah. It's a diaryl methine instead of a triaryl methine. Yeah. And so then here's the Marquis reagent reacting with morphine. So we have morphine, the molecule here, and it reacts with the Marquis reagent. And it also dimerizes. So here's a morphine on the left and a morphine on the right. We've got some new carbons in the middle that have connected those fused rings. And so then you put that in the developer solution of sulfuric acid, you ionize the molecule, and you get this violet color. Now, I don't really see an aromethine group. We have this carbocation, but I certainly see a lot of carbonyls. And so this is going to be a carbonyl system, where those non-bonded electrons are promoted to an antibonding orbital in the pi cloud on these fused rings. Yes?
Is octanone, is that like oxycatone?
No. Which one? Like, oh, oxonium cations. Now, I think they're probably talking about this.
Yeah.
Yeah, and carbonium. You know, again, these are just different words associated with those cations. Now that LSD is using dimethyl aminobenzaldehyde, okay, in the para position. So here's PDMAB. It reacts with LSD. Now, I also show you these reactions to show you some of the shorthand that's used in a lot of these texts. Okay, here's LSD. But it's quite a busy molecule, and so they've drawn this wiggly line there and basically ignored that part of the molecule because it's not important to the reaction. Okay? It's not as simple as just sticking an R group on there because you've got, it's splitting across one of these fused rings. And so we're just saying everything on the other side of this wiggly line is about to disappear. Okay? And so we have that here and we have that here. So on the other side of that wiggly line is all of that other stuff. Okay? But the reacting part is this indole ring. Now that's interesting because that tells us anything with an indole ring will probably react with this dimethyl ammonium benzaldehyde. And so what it does is it attaches itself to that indole ring, it forms this substance, and then it couples again with this carbocation to another indole ring, and then we pull off that proton and we make this triaryl methine group.
There are a lot of indole rings and proteins.
Yeah, the body has a lot of these kinds of 6-membered, 5-membered ring substances. Yeah, and so then again, this is it an azo dye? No. You know, you can do this by process of elimination pretty easily. Is it a nitro? No. But you see three aromatic regions connected by one carbon, so it's a triaryl methine coloring agent. And it's taking the substance, a part of the aromatic substance of LSD, and using that to make this colored structure. And you get a really strong coloring agent. You can detect just generic phenols and amines using the Lieberman test. And again, this, a lot of these things will take the substance you're trying to detect and dimerize them or trimerize them to get an extended pi cloud. And so we end up down here with this pH-dependent substance, and it's an acid, it's red, and base, it's blue. But what's going on? You have an extended structure and a carbonyl on the end. So it's not an aromethane. This is a nitrogen in the middle. It's only one nitrogen, so it's not an azo group. Okay. I don't see any nitros, so it's not a nitro or a nitroso.
It's a carbonyl.
Yeah, so it's a carbonyl. So the non-bonded electrons and that oxygen can be donated to the pi cloud. Likewise for the nitrogen, the non-bonded electrons can be promoted. So just trying to get your mind around the coloring agents that are going to give you visible peaks, and visible peaks give you color. And then here's a methamphetamine using the Simon test. So here's interesting, you've got two tests now for methamphetamine, the marquee reagent and the Simon all complex. And so a couple of spray tests, you've got one, okay, yeah, I got methamphetamine with the marquee reagent. Let's take some more powder, another sample with the, a different filter paper and use the Simon test reagent. And I get a color change there too. So now I have two presumptive tests for methamphetamine. I take some of that powder, make a lab sample, run it on a calibrated GC, and I get methamphetamine, so I have a confirmatory test. That's enough to take to court. One strong analytical measurement and two presumptive tests. If I don't have any of the color change tests, I need to use two strong analytical methods like GC and FTIR. But I may not have enough material to run an FTIR. So this can really help. If I get two presumptive tests and a confirmatory test, then I'm good. Because it's unlikely that this substance could not be methamphetamine and give both colors and a GC trace. So even though maybe the GC trace is only 95% confident in terms of its identification for very small samples, you say, well, there's a 1 in 20 chance I get through incorrectly in the GC, but there's a much smaller chance of getting through the GC and giving the correct color change on two presumptive tests.
So, like, is there a set of rules on, like, certain tests will be admissible in court and stuff like that?
Yes, and so that's kind of why we're still using these color tests, because they're admissible in court. Okay, but they're not by themselves. So you couldn't just say, well, we got two color changes, we know it's meth. The defense would say, no, you can get color changes from other kinds of compounds. So you need to confirm it with an analytical technique that's more robust. And those would be like FTIR, GC, especially GCMS. So GCMS actually gives you two pieces of data, the retention time and the M over Z, the molecular ion. So if you got a molecular ion that tells you it's methamphetamine, but it came out of the retention time that doesn't match methamphetamine, then you got a problem. Because one tells you it's not, the other tells you it is. How could that ever be the case? Well, maybe your GC is contaminated. Maybe it has methamphetamine in every background data point, right? So it's always got the red light on for methamphetamine, you know? And so you could be in a pickle, right? So it's got to be the right retention time, and it's got to be the right molecular ion or fragment pattern. And if you have color tests too, you make a pretty strong case. This one's interesting. It's not any of the ones that we covered, the aromethines or what have you. This is an inorganic complex. Similar to that copper ammonia complex was blue. This one's going to be a blue called a Simon-All complex, and it's this iron ferrocyanide. So this is a strong ligand. We'll stick to that iron. You got one extra ligand here, this piece that's connected all the way over to the methamphetamine. So this is sort of attaching that methamphetamine to this iron ferrocyanide. And then we can detect marijuana with this dupanoid reagent, where we take the GPLM. They put acronyms on everything. What do you think GPLM is? Green plant-like matter. Right? So you get this stuff out of, you know, some person's car is green, it kind of looks plant-like, okay? So it's green, plant-like material. You crush it up, and you put it in a culture tube, a couple of mils of ether, shake it, let it sit, and so you're drawing those ether-soluble compounds out. You decant it over to another tube, so you're not confused by the green plant-like material, and you add in this fucanyl reagent. And so you add hydrochloric acid first, and then you add some chloroform after you've added this reagent, and you get two different color changes, and you can write down your results. Okay. But it's on the ether extract of the GPLM that you do the test. Now, this is really important because you can't, I mean, you're not at the crime scene, right? So you're not going to be affected by this. But, you know, we were at the pet store in college, and I had a cat in my apartment. And my friend said, he said, man, my cat would really like some of this catnip. And so I said, yeah, my cat would too. This would be great. But it was like a brick of catnip. And I was like, I don't need that much, you know? And he's like, I don't either, right? So I said, well, let's go halvesies. And so he bought it, and I gave him some money, and he took the store package and busted it in half, and I had a lunch sack with the Ziploc in it, and I stuck this catnip in a Ziploc bag and zipped it up and drove home. And I forgot about it. And so it's under my seat in the car, and it's catnip, right?
But
I'm so glad. Like a week or two later, I discovered it, and I was like, holy crap, if I'd have rolled a stop sign.
Yeah, if you would have.
If I'd have had a taillight out or whatever, I would have had a Ziploc bag of green plant-like material under my seat.
It's a block.
Yeah, and I'm just like, it's catnip. He's like, well, you let the lab decide that, okay? But I'm hoping that if you extracted the compounds out of catnip and sprayed this in there, that we wouldn't get the correct color change. You know, I'm hoping.
We
should test it. Yeah, I don't have any of this reagent, but maybe, you know.
Oh my God.
But yeah, just, you know, totally innocent stuff can happen, and you know. But who's gonna believe you, right? Nobody, until you do the test, right? And so. I've always wanted to do this reagent test on catnip, just to see how much risk I was in. Yeah. Or if they would even do the test, you know, they'd be so biased to say, like, it's marijuana. There's no way that this guy's telling the truth, it's catnip.
Yeah. Would you go out?
I've never heard that before, yeah.
Would you go so far to do that?
You know, people mistake, like, sugar or anything like
that.
Yeah, like,
yeah. You know, like, you know, spilled white powder on the floor at HEB on the flower aisle is not a problem, right? But on the desk of the Secretary of State, you know, Colin Powell opens, zips up a, you know, a manila envelope, pulls the stuff out, and white powder falls out. And he's like, okay, we got a problem. It's in the floor of HEB, you know. So stop everything, wash my hands, call Homeland Security, come test this powder. You know, it was just a prank, but it was right after the anthrax thing, and they had spent, I don't know how many dollars, fumigating the congressional office building, because of the several congressional members received letters with anthrax in it. And so this stuff, they said it was weaponized, meaning it was a powder fine enough that could get into the air and not necessarily settle for quite a while, which means you could breathe it in. Anthrax is everywhere. It's in the soil. You've been exposed to it. And if you have any scratches or whatever, and it gets in those scratches, you can get a pretty bad skin infection from anthrax. But if you breathe it in and your immune system's weak, it can kill you. And so they evacuated the building, and they sealed up the windows, and they sprayed chlorine dioxide in there to kill anything living. So they sterilized the whole building. It was really very expensive. But they tested this powder on his desk, and it was apparently a prank. Okay, so again, it's like you said, sugar can be, you know, especially powdered sugar, you know, that's weaponized sugar. You ever puff it, it's like stays in the air, or even worse is the HEB lemonade, you know, like the Crystal Light stuff. Put that in the powder, you know, you put it in the little thing, and it's like, and you smell it in your nose, it's like, ah. Can't stand that.
I was like, I have a cat, you know, yeah. You pour lemon.
And I was always tried it every way. I've done the dry powder and like full blast on the water, you know, to try to hold the powder in there. I've had half water and poured it in the water, and I still get, so, you know, that's weaponized the lemonade powder. It can go right up your nose. So this is the coloring agent. This Duquenal reagent reacts with the THC compounds, and it attacks these fused rings. Notice how really these aliphatic hydrocarbon tails, they're just not reactive. Okay, that's why we make plastic milk jugs out of polypropylene. And we store a lot of chemicals in plastic bottles, but there's no unsaturation, so it's really not very reactive. But you've got these aryl rings, these aromatic rings, and you can come in and nestle up to an antibonding orbital and start pushing electrons. So this attacks this ring area. You've got this long extended hydrocarbon chain, a very low homolumo gap, cation, and so then you can have a colored agent here. This really, you've got these non-bonded electrons on this ether group, and so you can have an N to pi star transition. For this long a conjugation region, you can have a pi to pi star that's pretty low. And so I don't know, with this being such a long extended carbon chain, that whether it's a pi to pi star or a non-bonded N to pi star, but to classify this one, it's really not a carbonyl. It's more just an extended pi region. So it doesn't quite fit into the four categories of azo, nitro, nitroso, carbonyl, or triaryl-methine. Okay. But you just look at it and say, what's the chromophore? Well, it's going to be this extended pi cloud. You can use this as a spot developer, as we talked about. So you do this TLC, and then you spray fast blue on it, and you get the three different colors, and they'll tell you, you know, that this is particular type of marijuana. It's got all three, so it's confirmed. And then this fast blue reagent has got this azide group on here that makes an azo linkage to the aromatic ring on the THC. Now this is another notation that I wanted to point out. We saw the wavy line to kind of act like we use R groups in organic for just a single bonded thing. You put that wavy line to sort of strike out half the molecule that you're not interested in. Look at this notation. What is that supposed to mean?
It's fun to the actual.
Is it sitting in the middle of that ring? No.
No.
This is just saying we don't know and we don't care whether it's on that carbon or that carbon. Right? It could be at any one of these open spots.
They've gotten so lazy.
So lazy, yeah. But it's not important. It's going to give you a color change. Azo links to somewhere in this aromatic ring. Yeah. So after all, we've beaten into you in organic about being specific about all your molecules. They just totally skip a lot of the things and just draw a line in the middle of the ring. And even that's looked down upon by organic chemists.
It's like, we don't even know.
Yeah, we're like, double bonds, yeah, some resonance structures, whatever, you know. And then we'll just stick an azo on there someplace. Okay. So when you see this, you know it's an azo linkage. Don't be confused by this line going to the center of the ring. There's nothing there to bond to. It's just laziness. They could draw all of the different types of structures. In fact, there's probably some percentage of it bonded here, some percentage of it bonded there. And they're all going to give you some sort of change in the color. Okay. Now, how do we classify color? You know, I beat that drum in PCHEM on RGB just because we can set that on the screen very easily. You go and make a little color block, right-click, edit, pick the color RGB values, and then you get an idea of what that color is. Don't forget that, because RGB values are very useful. You can use them on the computer. But in terms of writing down colors, there are other color systems. Like this is the Munsell color system, and this is actually written into the National Institute of Justice, NIJ, National Institute of Justice, standard as to the colors of these. So if you're new and you're like, well, what is the color for this Duquenal-Levine test for THC, it's written up here in the standard. It's 7.5 PB, 4 over 4. 7.5 PB, 7 over 8. 7.5 P, 4 over 12. So we get three different colors of the three spots on the TLC plate.
Purple blue.
Yeah. And so PB, purple blue, I guess, you know, was.
I think so.
My son, when he was probably 5 or so, we asked, what's your favorite color? And he had learned the issues, right? He said, it's greenish bluish. So, like, parents are like, that's so cute, you know. So, but that's not cute when you're reading it in a standard, you know. Purplish bluish, right? So you've got to go to a standard color chart. And this is how the Munsell system is. You've got this ring of colors that go, you know, it's like the color wheel. It goes in Roy G. Biv, red, yellow, green, blue, violet. And then you've got this value that tells you from black to white, how bright it is, and then how colored it is, from pale color or gray right along that tube to really bright blue. And so these are numbered. These are the letters. And so around the outside you have red, yellow, yellow, green, yellow, green, yellow, green, green, blue, green, blue, green. So Thomas's favorite color would be probably right here, bluish greenish. blue, purple, you know, so it goes all the way around, and then purple red, and so then it loops around. So those are the letters. So we're looking for purple blue, so we're over here, and it's 7.5. So here's 5 purple blue, here's 10 purple blue, so it's between those two. And so I could look at this system and say, okay, I'm looking for a spot that's purplish bluish. And then a 4, 4, so it's going to be 4 bright, pretty dark, and then 4 out. Okay, so it's going to be a pretty dark color, not a bright purple blue, but a kind of a darker purple blue. A real white or pale purple blue would be up here around an 8. And so you can, but still, what do we say? It takes experience. And so you would have to get familiar with this using this system so that you could look at the standard and say, okay, for tea, I'm getting a green-yellow. For THC, I wonder what catnip would be. But maybe tea. So you can tell the difference. Tea is a plant-like material. It may not be green, but it's green tea. So you say, oh, green tea. You know, I could look at that under a microscope and say, yeah, that's not marijuana. But I could also do this Levine test and see the different color. Green, yellow is here, purple, blue is there. Very easy to tell. Yeah.
So the first number is like a black and red scale, basically? From like 0 to...
Yeah, I'd have to go back and look to see. This first one is actually around this
line. Oh, I meant out of like the 4 and 4.
And then the 4 and 4, which one's first and which one's second, I'd have to go back and review. I don't know if it's out and up or up and out. Yeah.
It makes sense if it was up and down.
Yeah.
I always say up and out.
But we'll have to check, because it might be the other way. You know, sure. Just your intuition may be wrong. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So.
Then their intuition is wrong.
Yeah, exactly. And so that's the main points of color tests. Anybody else coming in?
Okay. That's no. It. Oh, this thing.
Oh, from last class.
All right. Trace metals. Which technique is best suited for the analysis of trace metals? Gas chromatography, liquid chromatography, inductively coupled plasma, optical emission, and ion mobility spectrometry.
This is instrumental 3.0.
Yeah, instrumental.
2.0.
3.
3.
It's getting worse in 2. Okay.
At least we don't have to draw.
Oh, nice.
Good job, folks. So ion mobility, you're going to have vapor pressure. Okay, and metals aren't going to have vapor pressure that's detectable. Everything has a vapor pressure, but it's not detectable.
It's like the ICP.
Okay, so what technique would tell you nothing about trace metals? Scanning electron, X-ray, atomic absorption, infrared.
Yeah, that's definitely metal.
Whoa, we're kind of all over the board on this one. Okay, so it's infrared, because infrared is molecular vibrations. Mm-hmm. Now, I said nothing about metals. You might make the case that a metal oxide, you could tell the difference maybe between aluminum oxide and copper oxide, but the peaks are going to be really broad in the infrared. So I would say no, you're not going to detect metals with infrared. Atomic absorption spectroscopy is a metal technique. You're getting acid-digested metal, blowing it up, is turning into an atom of metal. You're using the cathode ray lamp to detect that. And these two you're not actually seeing the metal necessarily with, you know, with the microscopy part. You're hitting it with electrons and causing core electrons to leave, and you're getting X-ray emission here. And you're also getting it with X-ray fluorescence. You hit it with X-rays, you get X-rays out. You hit it with fast-moving electrons, and you can get X-rays out as well. And those X-rays are characteristic of the 1s orbital energy. Where are the 1s orbitals? Very close to the nucleus. What's the only thing that makes an atom different from another atom?
Protons.
The nucleus. Right? So those 1s electrons tell you what nucleus they're standing on. Okay. They're already standing on.
But the atom carbon. Protein still sends carbon.
Okay, what technique do the airports use to detect explosives and occasionally narcotics? Now we're talking about acronyms. So they wipe your bag with a little wipe, or your hands.
Oh,
they
vaporize.
Stick it in the thing, push the deal up.
They vaporize.
It's like, and if you've ever heard one of those go off, it's pretty scary because they want to make sure that the technician hears it. And what's IMS stand for?
Ion mobility spectroscopy.
Yeah, spectroscopy or spectrometry, because it's metric, it's moving, it's measuring the movement time, whereas spectroscopy, the scope part is light. So there is a slight difference between spectroscopy and spectrometry. Yeah,
words.
I know, who knew, right? But I'm not be picking on you, I'm just saying, that, you know, this is, this would, somebody would go, it's spectrometry, you know, instead of spectroscopy. And, they would be right. Okay, annoyingly right. Yeah. So which technique is not a surface technique? This was not a surface technique. What does that stand for? Inductively coupled plasma mass spec. But this, you've got to get something through a nebulizer.
Yeah.
It's like a dissolution.
Yeah, so you've got to get it in solution. So it's not a surface technique. It's very sensitive, but if you've got something that's a surface, like let's take a bullet, okay? Oh, I'll bring it next time. I have one in my jacket pocket for class, and I didn't bring my jacket down. But if you have a bullet and you want to measure the trace compounds on the surface of that bullet, do not dissolve the thing in acid. Right? Because you've got something that's on the very outside surface of just a few microns, and now you're going to dilute it by putting it in solution with all the other metal ions in there. Right? And so you would not use ICP-MS for like the copper jacket on a bullet. Okay? You'd want to use a surface technique like SEM. You put that bullet under a microscope, blast it with high energy electrons, and get the X-rays out of it. And that's only going to penetrate a few microns into the surface. So you're only detecting the surface and you're throwing away. You're not even looking at the lead on the inside or even the bottom half of the copper jacket. You're just detecting the surface. So there's a time for surface technique and a time for a bulk technique. If you're looking for impurities in lead, because you want to see, was this lead made by an American bullet company with an American source of lead, or was it made in China or someplace with a different source of lead, then you'd want to get to the lead and you want to try to look at trace metals in that lead. So you'd want as much of the bullet dissolved as possible, and you would ignore the lead, because that's going to be the strongest signal, and you look for the tiny little impurities that are in there. And American sources of lead are going to have different impurities than Chinese sources of lead. It's a mythical example, but it's the way it would fit. So you would want to use ICP-MS on the lead inside of a bullet. You'd want to use X-ray fluorescence or SEM-EDS for the copper jacket, the outside. Micro FTIR, anytime it says micro, on FTIR, that's a microscopic technique. I have one of those in my lab. It's a microscope that will take an FTIR spectrum. But it's not going to tell you anything about the metal. But it is a surface technique. In normal phase chromatography, the stationary phase is?
Missing.
Thank you.
Wait, what'd she say?
She said missing. Yeah, I thought that was funny. I was like, I have to put a joke in there. I could only come up with so many distractors. The things that are not right are called distractors. So the normal phase means the stationary phase is polar. Yay! Good job, folks. Hey, we got a little flaming hot streak there.
All this time, professor, I just realized that's what FT means in FTIR. I was like, I knew what the Fourier transform was, and now I'm like, oh.
Yeah, there you go.
Oh.
That's great. Okay, we got one more. Let's take the colorimetry one. We got time.
That's too cool.
Why'd you bring the explosive kits?
I was going to show you some of these little test kits. That just, this is what you take to the scene. And here's your little color card telling you what a positive result is. And you got the little sprays and your wipes. So you just sit here, you got the wipe, peel off the little backing, dab, 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 dab. Spray, spray, it works, you know.
No, Ashley.
What?
I'm not for something to you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. I was waiting.
You didn't get that drill.
Oh my god.
There we go. Okay, we're good.
It's on camera.
You got it.
You're good.
Cool.
Oh my god.
Oh my god, I'm sorry.
You should have turned it when you
had
done
it. I got some of it.
It's not even cool anymore, but that's just funny because it's chemistry.
Colorimetric test, you have to know how to do.
Then I fail on purpose.
You gotta do it with two fingers.
I fail on purpose and have fun.
You gotta lean yourself down.
No.
It's a new way of dabbing.
You have to keep it.
You gotta start a new dance
movie.
Exactly. I've always wanted to do
it. It's the
colorimetric
dabbing.
We need to do the water stretching dance.
Yeah. No. That one I'll do. I'll do that one. I'll do the symmetric stretching.
Yeah.
I'm losing y'all quick.
That is true.
Alright.
That is true.
What is the identity of this drug?
Uh-oh.
Rut-row?
Uh-oh. My screen fell asleep. Just to see, I mean, this should sort of pick some of these things up by osmosis and seeing the notes.
Peter.
Okay, so that's the So here's this. Look for this tree structure and this little aliphatic tail kicking off.
Yeah.
That's sort of the structure of all of the THC compounds. All right, let's see what we got.
No.
That's cheap though. They put the rings as being like. On the oxygen part.
Yeah,
on the main part.
What piece of the structure are you looking at? Good job, 8 out of 8. So, you look at...
And it's gone.
It's
nice.
Because it's a PNG, it has transparency, so it's not showing up. Anyway, but you're looking for that tropane ring. What type of chromophore is this?
What's your chromophore?
Oh no, my screen fell asleep. There we go.
Okay.
I need to try.
And this is basic red 18, so that's that's like a acid-base
indicator.
And
it matches.
Yeah.
It matches, too.
All right, that's
that was it?
Yeah. All right, we caught up on the goodness. Good job.